Thank you for joining us during the Research Culture Week. It's been a pleasure for us to have such a caliber of speakers, as well as all of you in the audience. Today, this afternoon, we will hear Professor Derk-Jan Dijk. He's a professor of sleep and physiology at the University of Surrey. He's also the director of the Surrey Sleep Research Centre and group leader of the UK Dementia Research Institute. In this talk, entitled Sleep Sufficiency, Stress and Success, Professor Dijk will explore and discuss ways to help us enhance our well-being by improving our sleep patterns. Thank you, Derk-Jan.
Okay, good afternoon. Thank you very much for the invitation. I hope you can all hear me and see my screen. I'm going to say a few things about sleep sufficiency, stress, and success in the context of the Research Culture Week. The promise of sleep. We hear a lot about sleep in the media, and everybody tells you that sleep is important. Sleep well, and you will be happy, healthy, slim, successful, and live forever. That's basically the promise of sleep. Of course, there are other promises in the world. For those of you who now and then go to a pub, you may see this advertisement, free beer tomorrow. Think a little bit about this. This is a good way to get you back in the pub, and you will see the same advertisement every day. Maybe it's a little bit like this with sleep as well. But let's first see how we actually appreciate sleep and how sleep contributes to several aspects of our life. Here, I'm going to talk about the contribution of sleep to enjoyment. So what are these data? These are not my data. This is from a book which was published a year ago, What We Really Do All Day. And the investigators asked 8,000 men and women to complete a time diary. And they had to report every 10 minutes what they were doing. And they were doing this for 1 or 2 days. And they also had to indicate how much they enjoyed what they were doing. 7 is you're enjoying it very much, and 1 is you're not enjoying it at all. And then you have various activities, and together, of course, this adds up to 24 hours, and this is how much you enjoy it. So let's see what these activities are. What you are not enjoying is looking for a job, laundry. Slightly better for domestic work, but commuting is still not fun. It's starting to become interesting when we do shopping or writing letters, cooking, and then we are at 5.5 here. If you browse the internet, you do some outdoor activities, reading to or teaching a child, walking is quite popular. Talking to people is popular, knitting crafts or celebrations and hobbies. And then, of course, sleep scores more than 6, and you're spending, 8 hours per day on that. So if you look at the area under the curve, sleep is the behavior that contributes the most to enjoyment. You may wonder what's in this last category. If you want to read it, you will see that it's going to a restaurant, pub or bar, or play with a child is also something that really contributes to enjoyment. So if you really want to enjoy yourself, play with a child while you are in a pub or bar or restaurant. During lockdown, some of these things are not possible. So what you really should do is sleep. So that's sleep and enjoyment. What about sleep and well-being? These are also not my data. This is actually sponsored by Sainsbury. And Sainsbury created the Living Well Index. And they published this in 2017. They interviewed more than 8,000 participants with 60 questions. And then they could put people in the top or in the bottom of well-being. So these are the eight factors that explain the most difference between the top and bottom. And you can see that overdue debts actually don't really contribute that much to your well-being. So if you have study debts, don't worry about it. Spending time outdoors contributes. Mental health contributes to well-being. A support network, which of course is also important for early career researchers and postgraduate researchers, is very important. But then of course, sleep quality, you will not be surprised, is the most important factor in terms of determining whether you are in the top or the bottom 20 of well-being. Of course, the good news is that these data were not collected by sleep researchers. Sleep researchers have a conflict of interest and are biased when it concerns sleep. These were not sleep researchers. You can go slightly further and say, well, well-being is one thing, but what about mental and physical health? How important is sleep for mental and physical health? This is what is referred to as the UK Household Longitudinal Study, where they collect data during wave one and then again in wave four. There are 30,000 people in that particular survey, and they looked at predictors of general health and the mental component and the physical component of the short form healthy survey. And if you look at the mental component and the general health quality 12, which is to a larger extent also focused on mental health, you see that sleep quality by far is the most significant predictor of mental health. Interestingly, you know, sleep quantity is less of a contributor, sleep medication use a little bit. It's also interesting that sleep quality primarily contributes to mental health, according to these data, and less to physical health. So these are data that weren't collected by my lab. Fortunately, we also collected some data. This is a smaller sample of approximately 400 people, and they were characterized extensively with a large number of questionnaires and other tools. And then we can look at the contribution of sleep quality, sleep duration, or chronotype to general health, mental health, or physical health. And again, we see that sleep quality contributes enormously to mental health, also to general health and physical health. But mental health is certainly the most dependent or associated with self-reported sleep quality. Sleep duration isn't that important, and chronotype, so whether you are an early bird or a late type, doesn't make much of a difference. So I guess I've now convinced you that sleep quality, self-reported sleep quality, is important. So the next question is, you know, what makes a good night's sleep? You know, what does your sleep pattern look like after a poor night of sleep versus a good night of sleep? So to look at that, we have to record sleep physiology. We can do this in the laboratory. You know, we attach electrodes to your head and to your rib cage to monitor breathing. We can quantify these EEG records, and we can determine sleep stages. Here you are awake, the lights go out, you go in light sleep, slightly deeper sleep, deep sleep. At one point you go into rapid eye movement sleep, where you may dream quite a bit and you see the night progressing. And then sometimes you also wake up in the middle of the night, which you may or may not remember the next morning. And this is the end of sleep. You can also quantify the EEG, the brain waves, by doing a spectral analysis of the EEG, and you can look at how much slow wave activity, so low frequency activity, there is in the EEG, and you see there is a particular pattern there. So now when you have this information, you can extract many parameters: sleep latency, sleep efficiency, non-REM sleep, sleep continuity, REM sleep awakenings, and total sleep time. So now you can ask the question, what is it of these measures that contributes the most to you saying in the morning, this was a good night's sleep? So, and this is exactly what we ask you. Quality of sleep last night, Zero is very bad and 100 is very good. So it's a simple visual analog scale. So here we did this in 206 people. And these people were between 20 and 84 years old. And now on this horizontal axis, you see those sleep measures I was talking about, number of awakenings, sleep efficiency, latency to sleep, deep sleep, slow wave sleep, or that low wave, slow wave activity. And here we have a measure of effect size, Kendall's tau. So this basically tells you how much each of these measures contributes to sleep quality. And you see that we see the largest contribution, a negative contribution for the number of awakenings. So if according to your brainwaves, you wake up several times per night, then in the morning, you will say, I didn't sleep well, even though you may not remember how often you woke up. You may wonder what makes a good night's sleep. So you need to look for positive correlations here. And in this data set, what we find is that rapid eye movement sleep, if you have a lot of that dream sleep, then you will report that you slept well in the morning. Aspects of how long it took you to fall asleep, or slow wave sleep, deep sleep, actually don't contribute that much to sleep. So you may wonder, are there differences between people in how their sleep quality depends on their sleep physiology? And yes, in this analysis, we can also compare men versus women. And if we look at these two variables, number of awakenings and REM sleep that contributed to subjective sleep quality, we see that for the women in red, that contribution is much stronger than in the men. Now, how do you explain this? You know, one explanation is women complain more about their sleep, and that's why you see stronger correlations. The other explanation is, well, men don't listen to their sleep physiology. When you ask them in the morning, how did you sleep? They just say something which has nothing to do which actually happened during the night in terms of sleep physiology, whereas apparently the women can very accurately report their sleep quality in how it relates to sleep physiology. So that's one thing I wanted to cover, subjective sleep quality. So what else? Aging. Some of us are young, others are older, and it's pretty clear that sleep physiology changes with age, even over the adult lifespan. And this is an example. What you're looking at is what is referred to as slow wave activity, so low frequency brain waves during sleep. And we look at one night of a 31-year-old woman and one night of a 30-year-old man. And you can see that in both men and women, slow wave activity is high at the beginning of the night and then declines. And you can see that women have more slow wave than men when you are in your 30s. And the same holds when you are in your 70s. The women still have more, but you can see that there is a massive change, reduction in slow waves. So basically, there are age-related changes in sleep physiology, even when you are very healthy. So now, of course, a lot is being said about aging and sleep, and there are some myths and there are some truths around aging and sleep. You know, one may say that older people are more sleepy during the day, maybe because they don't get enough deep sleep. Others say older people may need more or less sleep than young people, and what's the right answer? Another question is, and maybe this is a proposition, are early career researchers and postgraduate researchers more sleepy during the day because they don't get enough sleep? So how are you going to answer that kind of question? Now, one simple way to know whether you get enough sleep is by simply asking, are you sleepy? And this may sound trivial, but I'll show you data later that this is probably the best way to measure whether your sleep is okay. But if that's the question, then the question becomes how to measure sleepiness. Fortunately, there is a very sensitive and robust scale, the Karolinska sleepiness scale. It's a simple 9-point scale where you go from extremely alert, very alert, alert, neither alert, sleepy, sleepy, some effort to keep awake, to 9, very sleepy, great effort to keep awake, fighting sleep. So now you can ask people to complete that scale. And we did this in a larger group of people. And first we asked about subjective sleepiness, so the score on that Karolinska sleepiness scale. Higher scores mean you're more sleepy. So if you ask people in their 20s, in their 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, what you see in these healthy people, that yes, the young people are very sleepy compared to the old people. Of course, some people will say, well, these older people don't know how sleepy they are. That's just self-report. You need to objectively assess sleepiness. You can do this in something that's referred to as the daytime sleep latency test. 5 times per day, you are asked to take a nap, and then we see how fast you fall asleep. So if the duration, the time that elapses until you fall asleep is shorter, you are obviously sleepier. And now we have the same age groups, and you can see that the young people have a multiple sleep latency test, an average over those 5 tests of 10 minutes or slightly above 10 minutes, and the older people are far less sleepy. So never think that when you're old, you should be sleepy because that's the norm. No, when you're old and you're sleepy, then there is something wrong with your sleep. Now, the question, of course, is why are these young people so sleepy? Is that, you know, because they don't get enough sleep? But before I go there, I just want to show you that this difference between the young and the older is not just observed in the average of these 5 tests, but you see this in the morning test at 9 o'clock, in the morning test at 11 o'clock, at 1 o'clock, at 3 o'clock, and at 5 o'clock. Here, of course, you can also see the well-known mid-afternoon dip. You see the shorter sleep latencies at around 3 o'clock in the afternoon. But at all time points, younger people take less time to fall asleep or are more sleepy than older people. So the question becomes, do young people need more sleep than older people? And how can you find out? You can find out in many different ways. This is an experiment we did many years ago, actually, in Boston. And this was an interesting experiment. We had younger and older people, and they were asked to stay in bed for 16 hours per 24 hours, 12 hours at night and 4 hours during the day. And then we just looked at how much sleep people can get when you have a 16-hour sleep opportunity per 24 hours. So this is total sleep time. We had older individuals, 18, and younger individuals, 35. And what you can see is that the younger people, and we did this for 7 days, the younger people consistently sleep longer than the older people. And that difference is actually, you know, 1.5 hours. Yeah. So the young people have an asymptotic sleep capacity or sleep need of 8.9 hours, whereas in the older people, that's only 7.4 hours. Now, this is data collected when they are in bed for 16 hours. This is how much sleep they got normally. And you can see that that's far less than this time point here. So indeed, normally people build up a sleep debt. And that's why initially there is this increase in sleep duration. So what does this mean? If we look at age and we look at sleep need, I think it's fair to say that it goes down with age. What probably happens in terms of sleep duration or time in bed you know, that the young people don't sleep, don't spend enough time in bed and build up a sleep debt, and that's why they are sleepy. And older people sometimes may have disrupted sleep because they spend too much time in bed. The problem, of course, is that the literature and the media like to see one number, the recommended sleep duration, which after controlling for age then comes to a number which isn't correct for anyone in the population. You may say, well, you know, this is very exciting. You know, we were very exciting when we collected all of these data. Of course, you know, we also do public engagement and send out press releases, and this is wonderful. And I will recommend that everybody in science is doing it. And sometimes you get fantastic feedback from the audience you reach out to. This is a letter I received after we had published some kind of a press release on that phenomenon that older people are less sleepy and probably need less sleep. So I got this lovely letter. I will read it to you. You can probably not read it. Dear Sir Miss, why don't you do something useful instead of wasting public money on stupid research? I knew, note the spelling, for years that older people need less sleep and young people need 7.5 to 8 hours sleep. For goodness sake, people have known this for 30 to 40 years. Stop wasting money on stupid projects. Do something useful. And this, of course, is the kind of feedback you're really, you know, looking forward to, because it encourages you to do even more exciting research. So I'm going to say a few things about epidemiology of sleep. And these people here are on Troll's Tongue, which is in Hordaland in Norway. And there is a Hordaland survey, a longitudinal study, which is quite famous. These authors published on sleep data from that longitudinal study and survey. So this is sleep timing and duration in adolescents, and there are 9,846 adolescents in that survey, and these are some of the data. So during weekdays, the bedtime in these adolescents is 18 minutes after 11. During the weekends, it's much later. It's 33 minutes after 1. Rise time, so when do they get up in the morning, is before 7 during weekdays and after 11 during weekends. And you can see this pattern here. If you look at how much time they spend in bed, it's 7.5 hours during weekends and 9.75 of an hour during weekends. And sleep duration is 6.5 during weekdays and 8 hours and 37 minutes during weekends. Now, these people also reported subjective sleep need. And these younger people said, well, on average, I probably need 8 hours and 35 minutes, which, of course, implies that during the week, these people build up a sleep deficit of 10 hours. So the question is, you know, what happens if you build up that kind of sleep deficit? So we did a study here in Surrey in the clinical research building, and we were very lucky to have that building. And in one condition, people were in the lab, and we had 36 people in there in a crossover design, and total 850 inpatient days. So after a baseline sleep period, they got a 10-hour sleep opportunity for a week, and then we kept them awake for an entire a day, night, and the next day, and then they had recovery sleep. In the other condition, insufficient sleep, they were only allowed to be in bed for 6 hours. If you do this in the 10-hour condition, people on average get 8.5 hours of sleep, and in the 6-hour condition, 5.7 hours. You can do mathematical modeling of that, but I won't go into it. So the question is, you know, what happens if you don't get enough sleep? So how can you measure aspects of brain function? Well, first, you can ask about mood, you know, positive and negative affect. Are you interested, distressed, excited, upset? You can also ask people, how much effort do you have to put in completing a particular task, like a working memory task? and you can ask people about, you can probe working memory in people by using something what is referred to as an NBAC task. And the NBAC can be one BAC where you see a letter on the screen and you need to say whether it's identical to the previous letter. In the two BAC, you need to say whether the letter you see is identical to the one, two presentations back. And for the three back, you need to say whether the letter is identical to the one you saw three screens before. So that's working memory. And obviously the one back is easier than the two back is easier than the three back. You can also mention measure reaction times on the psychomotor vigilant task where stimulus appears, but with relatively large intervals. So it's a boring task, and then you can measure the reaction time. So now what you can do is look at which aspect of sleep is most affected by not getting enough sleep. Obviously, so this is an implied effect size so that you compare different measures. So this is 1 week of insufficient sleep. And here we have the KSS, the Karolinska Sleepiness Scale. And you see that this has a larger effect size than the PVT, that psychomotor vigilance task, that relatively boring reaction time. This is another attention task. And here we see these memory tasks, the one back, the two back, and the three back. And you see that the effects of not getting enough sleep on these more complicated tasks is actually far less, far smaller than on the simple assessment of how sleepy you are. And this is a very consistent finding in the literature. And it shows two things. First of all, that subjective sleepiness is extremely sensitive to insufficient sleep. So when somebody asks me, doctor, how do I know whether I get enough sleep? I simply say, are you sleepy? If the person says yes, then I say, well, you don't get enough sleep. The person says no, I said, then you're fine. So you don't have to do any complicated task. But this, of course, is interesting. So your brain is still able to engage with a task if it really has to. I won't go into too much detail. But so you keep up relatively good performance. But if I now ask you, how much effort did you have to put into doing that task? And in this particular case, indeed, these working memory tasks, you see that the effect size for effort is enormous. In other words, if you don't get enough sleep, you may still perform reasonably well, but it's going to take you much more effort, which basically implies that if you want to have an alert and effortless life, you should simply make sure you get enough sleep. And this has been reported in many studies, and I won't go into that. But of course, you want to know whether there are other consequences of not getting enough sleep. So here we looked at a gene expression in blood. You can measure transcripts in blood, and of course there are nucleated cells in blood, so genes are expressed, and you can look at the RNAs. And we have done this in Surrey, and the first thing we did is, you know, are things constant over the 24-hour day, or do they go up and down? In the background here, you see the melatonin rhythm. Melatonin is high during the night. It's the hormone of darkness. And you can see that some transcripts have low values during the night. Other transcripts have high values during the night. And these are the night peaking transcripts, and these are the day peaking transcripts. You can look at, you know, what these genes or these transcripts and their proteins are doing. During the night, there is a lot going on in terms of regulation of gene expression. And during the day, there's a lot of activity that has to do with the immune system and inflammatory responses. So now you can say, what happens if I don't get enough sleep? Well, actually, we see that some transcripts go down. They are down-regulated if you don't get enough sleep restriction. And other transcripts are upregulated. And you can do this for the entire transcriptome. You can ask the bioinformaticians to make nice networks. And you see that in that particular studies, that out of the 22,000 genes analyzed, 444 were downregulated, 267 upregulated. The upregulated ones are related to response to stress, response to reactive oxygen. Here you see interleukin 6, which is also related to immune function. So yes, you can start understanding that not getting enough sleep has some consequences for your health, and maybe it has some consequences for your immune system. And of course, immune function in the times of COVID is an important thing to look at. Something slightly less dangerous than COVID is the common cold. And this is a study not from my lab, but from the lab of Cohen in the US, who quite a few years ago now looked at sleep duration as a predictor of the consequences of being exposed to the common cold virus, a rhinovirus. And so they were exposed, then they were self-isolating, and then they were monitored for whether they were developing a clinical cold. And you can see that the people who usually slept less than 7 hours were much more likely to actually develop clinical symptoms compared to the people who slept 8 hours or more. So some of these variations in sleep duration really seem to have some consequences for, in this particular case, the immune system. But there are other aspects and other effects of sleep. I won't go into much detail, but one of the consequences of not getting enough sleep is that you will be hungry. If you don't sleep and if you are sleepy, people will report being hungry and they will eat more. Also, hormones implicated in the regulation of appetite, in this particular case, ghrelin, are affected by insufficient sleep. And that's why there is indeed an association between habitual sleep duration and obesity. And these kind of associations are particularly strong in younger people. So here we have a meta-analysis of 24,000 participants. It's not my study, Fatima et al. And these are young people up to 18 years. And what we here look at is the odd ratio for being obese or overweight if you sleep less than 8 specific recommended sleep duration. And you see that you're 2 times as likely to be obese or overweight if, as a young person, you sleep less than the recommended duration for your age group. So if you want to stay slim, the best way to accomplish that is by getting enough sleep, because you will be less hungry. Okay, so we talked a little bit about only sleeping for 6 or 5 hours. But if you're very busy and you have to study, or you have to do an experiment, or you have to write a paper, or you have to finish your PhD thesis, you may pull an all-nighter now and then. And you may wonder what happens to my performance and brain during an all-nighter. Now, several people have looked at this. This is a study or analysis I did many years ago. So here we have prior wakefulness, or also saying how long have you been awake. Of course, in the morning it's 0 hours. Normally after 16 hours you go to sleep. If you pull an all-nighter and don't go to sleep until the next evening, you will have been awake for 40 hours. Okay, so now we can measure all kinds of things. Here we're looking at body temperature, and you see a wonderful circadian rhythm in body temperature with a nadir in the morning hours and a maximum relatively late in the in the day. We can ask you how alert you are. And you see that, yes, when you just wake up, you're a bit sleepy. But then for the first 16 hours, you're pretty much alert. But then you enter the night, you're becoming more and more sleepy. And then here, the second day, there is a little bit of an upswing. The circadian clock helps you to be slightly more alert than during the night. So this pattern has been described for more than 100 years. But the question is, you know, can you see these kind of responses also when you look at specific aspects in the brain. And this is a study we did in collaboration with people in Liège, Pierre Marquet. In particular, they have access to an fMRI scanner. So the experiment they did is they kept people awake for 42 hours. Then they gave them 12 hours of sleep. And during this period, they did a total of 13 fMRI sessions. Yeah, so that's quite a bit. And now you can look at brain responses at all of these times and also after recovery sleep and see how your brain responses change. You know, is it a simple function of time awake or do you see some kind of rhythmicity? And also, can you see effects of recovery sleep? And this in 33 individuals. Now, these are all the brain areas, so quite a few, in which there was a rhythm in responses observed. And actually, it turns out that all these brain areas had a slightly different timing of these rhythms. So here we're looking at the amygdala, and here we are looking at another area, and you can see that activity in the amygdala peaks much earlier than in the inferior frontal gyrus. So that's one message. Things go up and down in your brain and don't peak at the same time for every brain area. You can also see very different patterns. So in the next slide, we're going to compare the superior temporal sulcus and the thalamus. So here we see the brain responses in the thalamus in the course of that experiment. So in the background, you again see melatonin. And here we're looking at the Bolt response. And you see that the Bolt response is primarily rhythmic. You don't see much of a linear time course. And you know, on the second day of sleep deprivation and recovery, you are at the same level. This is very different to this particular area where you can clearly see a pattern that during the day, the first 16 hours, the response is pretty much constant, just as I showed you for alertness. Then there is this steep decline with a nadir in the morning hours, and then there is this recovery. And then, of course, but you never recover to baseline levels. For that, you really need to have your recovery sleep, because then indeed you see full recovery. And that basically means that your brain is sensitive to both time of day and sleep-wake history, and the relative contribution of these two processes differs across brain areas. So that's another aspect I briefly wanted to cover. So in the last part of the presentation, although I still have quite a few slides on sleep, I'm going to say a few things about sleep timing. And the basic question is, why do you sleep so late and struggle to get out of bed in the morning? So if we ask the question, you know, what's the natural time for people to wake up, you know, in non-industrialized societies? We have to go to Africa, and I didn't do this. Yetis and Siegel did this, and they went to Tanzania. And in Tanzania, we have the Hazda people who are still hunter-gatherers, and they have no electric light. They know how to make fires. And what Jerry Siegel and his colleagues did is that they measured light exposure in these people, and they also measured sleep by wearables, ActiWatches. And this is sunrise and this is sunset. And you can see that they see a lot of light in the morning. Light remains high, although there is slightly less in the afternoon. That's probably because it's too hot. And they go and look for shade. And then here we have sunset. Now, first of all, if you look at sleep, wake time occurs before sunrise. Yeah, they don't go to sleep until several hours after sunset. They sit around campfires and tell stories, probably. Okay, so naturally, we wake up before dawn. Now, if you go to Surrey, and you ask people when they wake up. So now we're not talking about the Hazda people, the people of Surrey. And we can look at a year time And this is the hawk's back. And you can plot the timing of dawn. Here you have to change to summertime. And here you have to change back to standard time. And now you can look at wake time and bedtime and separately for weekdays and weekends. And you see that for most of the year, even during weekdays, we wake up several hours after dawn. And during weekends, it's even worse. And we also go to sleep several hours after dusk. And in the weekend, that's even worse. And we don't really listen to the seasons. But the important thing is we wake up several hours after dawn. So why is this? So, and to answer that question, you need to ask the question, you know, how is sleep timing regulated in the first instance? Well, the way sleep timing is regulated is by a clock, except this is a clock in your brain, the circadian clock. And that circadian clock is synchronized to the 24-hour world by light input. If you remove light input, your clock is no longer synchronized, but starts to free run with the period longer than 24 hours. So these were experiments done back in the 1960s in Germany, where people were kept in basements and underground bunkers for a month and longer. Initially, they had access to time of day and natural light, but then they had no longer access to natural light, so the 24-hour cycle of light and no time of day information. But they could switch on and switch off the artificial light. And you see that under those conditions, people go to sleep later every day when they are exposed to a light-dark cycle. And then post-light-dark cycle again, they again become synchronized to the 24-hour day. So this basically means light is important. So what's the difference between the Hadza and us? So this is the modern industrial pattern in red, and in blue we have the hunter-gatherer, and here we have light intensity. So in the hunter-gatherer, they will be outside during the day and get a lot of daylight, whereas most of us are inside. You know, we may see a little bit of light on the commute, especially when we walk, but inside we don't get much light. And then in the evening, we see more light than the hunter-gatherers, because we now have access to artificial light, and then we go to bed later than the hunter-gatherers. Okay, so there is now an important difference between the olden days and the modern days. In the olden days, we had the natural light-dark cycle, a circadian oscillator, and a sleep-wake cycle. In the modern days, we have the natural light-dark cycle, the circadian oscillator, the sleep-wake cycle, but it's the sleep-wake cycle that to a large extent determines our exposure to light, because we don't turn off the light until we go to sleep, okay? So the sleep-wake cycle now drives to a large extent your light exposure. So now you may ask the question, how important is this? And how important is that evening light? So you can measure light exposure by this wearable. This is an ActiWatch with has a light sensor in it. And you can look at blue, green, red light. And you can ask people, in this particular case, 22 people in Surrey, to wear such a sensor over several weeks. And then you can make average light exposure plots. So what is plotted here is a measure of light exposure, irradiance. This is sleep. This is wake and this is sleep and wake. The data are double plotted. We have also plotted dawn and dusk in the course of the experiment. Of course, dawn and dusk changes a little bit. And what we see is that also these people didn't wake up before dawn, but after dawn. We see that light exposure rises. Now, this experiment was done in November, December, January, if I remember correctly. So you see that dusk is very early, you know, at around 4 o'clock. It's dark outside now. But you see that there still is quite a bit of light exposure, artificial light exposure in the evening, okay? And then you go to sleep. So the question is, what is this artificial light doing to your circadian system? So we brought these people to the lab and exposed them to light. This is the light they saw at home in the blue, green, and red wavelengths. In one condition, they were in near darkness. In a blue depleted condition, which still had light in general lower than what they saw at home, something that was very similar to what they saw at home, and then higher intensities. So now you can look at the consequences of that light exposure in the evening. So we have numbered these conditions 1 to 5. We measure melatonin. This is melatonin in the evening when you're exposed to near darkness. And you can see there is a nice rise of melatonin, which starts, you know, approximately before 9, actually. Whereas as soon as you turn on that artificial light, even in condition 2 and 3, which is very similar to what you see at home, you already see suppression of this output, which is driven by the circadian clock. And the question is, why does this matter? Well, melatonin matters because if we look at where we normally go to sleep, and so we look at the drive for wakefulness, which increases until the evening and then suddenly dissipates, that actually coincides with the increase in melatonin. And that's referred to as the opening of the sleep gate. So if we suppress melatonin, this is where we normally sleep. If we suppress melatonin, that sleep gate may not open. So you can look at the consequences of light in the evening by, again, simply asking people how sleepy you are with that Karolinska sleepiness scale. And you can see that the more biologically effective the light is in terms of melatonin suppression, the less sleepy you are. So here you are, you turn on the light in the evening, and that light makes you less sleepy, which of course makes you less likely to go to sleep, which in turn means that you keep the lights on longer. And now, of course, you have a positive feedback loop. Actually, when you turn off the light, there are residual effects of light, certainly when the light was bright. So here you can look at how long it takes you to fall asleep after you have turned off the light. If the light was very bright, you see that it takes you longer to fall asleep. Okay, so we now know that lights, even from laptops and other gadgets, can have that effect. So you think, okay, well, that's not too bad. So I'm a little bit less tired, less sleepy because of the light. But there is more. Light in the evening also slows down your biological clock, so pushes the entire clock later, which means that now you're even less tired in the evening. You nevertheless have to get up in the morning, so you get sleep deprived, et cetera, et cetera. So this feedback loop basically means light in the evening, sleep later, struggle in the morning. You may say, that's a simple scheme. You know, can you be a little bit more quantitative about this? And can you actually predict, you know, how much light you need or how much harm, how much light is doing? So for this, you know, we need to follow the science or use a mathematical model. Predictions have become quite popular. This is a mathematical model developed by Andrew Phillips in Sydney, and Anne Skeldon, who is here at Surrey, has modified it and has done a lot of simulations with it. An important input into that model is light in a quantitative manner. Then there are certain brain areas. There is that circadian clock. And there is something that keeps track of how long you have been asleep and how long you have been awake. And obviously there are equations there. So now you can create this model. And what you can do is you can give the light exposure pattern of the Hazza to the model. And remember, this is where these people woke up before dawn. And now you see that the model also wakes up before dawn. And the model also stays awake until several hours after dusk. So the model can certainly replicate the data, the natural sleep-wake behavior. So what happens if you give the model access to artificial light, which means the model can turn on and turn off the artificial light? So this is sunset, this is sunrise. this is where you get access to artificial light. And you see that as soon as you get access to artificial light, the model goes to sleep later compared to when you had no access to artificial light. And that effect becomes stronger if you have access to more evening light. Now, it turns out that not everybody is similarly or equally affected by the evening light. What you need to know is that some of us have a fast circadian clock and others have a slow circadian clock. In approximately a quarter of people, the clock actually is faster than 24 hours. And in some people, the clock is as slow as 24.5. If you have a slow clock, you're more likely to be an evening type. If you have a fast clock, you're more likely to be a morning type. And this is the distribution of periods. So what you now can do is look at these effects of evening light. So 40 lux versus 5 lux. And you can do a dose response curve. But now you can also do this dose response as a function of how fast or slow your clock is. So this is the average clock speed, 24.2. If you have a fast clock, so if you're a morning type, the evening light doesn't do much harm. But if you have a slow clock, then the more evening light you get, the more you delay. So being an evening type by your genetic makeup makes it important to not get too much evening light because you will delay very much. Of course, you want to know whether the model has work days and weekends, and can you kind of simulate this pattern of sleeping late on Saturdays and Sundays and waking up in the morning. And actually, you can do this because you can force the model to wake up. Yeah, and you can see that if you do that, so the darker bars are when you force the model to wake up during the weekdays, but not during the weekend, you see this galloping pattern. But there's something else. So here you see these orange circles, and that basically is a marker of the circadian clock. And normally it's easy for you to wake up a couple of hours after this phase marker. If you get access to evening light and you set an alarm, these orange circles shift very close to where now you are forced to get up in the morning. It's at this time that your circadian clock makes you extremely sleepy. And that's why you are really struggling to wake up in the morning. So you see that evening light is not a good thing. This difference between timing of sleep during weekends and weekends is referred to as social jet lag. And social jet lag may be zero, so you wake up on weekends and weekdays at the same time, or maybe you wake up as much as 4 hours later. You can now see how that social jet lag depends on how much evening light you get. And the more evening light, the more social jet lag. Yeah. But the thing is that if you have a slow clock, that social jet lag is more severe. Another reason to think about light. Of course, some people have said, well, you know, waking up in the morning is difficult. I can't wake up at 7 o'clock. So why don't I start working at 10 or 11 rather than 7 or 8? And then there will be no problem. What the model tells you is actually that doesn't really work. Initially, it works. But after a couple of weeks, your clock has simply shifted later. And you can simulate this. So this is work by Anne Skeldon. She compared two interventions. One is change the alarm from 7 to 8. So go to work 1 hour later. And this is reducing evening light. And what you see here is the reduction in social jet lag. So higher is better. And here, this is done for somebody who has a 24-hour clock. This is a 24.2-hour clock. And these are these people with a very slow clock who were already evening types. And you can see that changing the clock from 7 to 8 doesn't help those late people at all. after a couple of weeks, they have the same problem, where simply reducing the evening light, even only from 40 to 30 lux, gives you a reduction in your social jet lag. So why do we sleep so late? Because we have access to artificial light. How to treat sleeping light, how to treat sleeping late, sorry, turn off the light, and the late chronotypes will benefit the most. So the advice is indeed follow the signs, as we have heard so often in recent months. And if there is no signs, you should simply follow common sense. This was covered in The Guardian, putting sleep myths to bed. Experts answer the question that keep you awake at night. This is the problem. You can't eat all that cheese at this time of night. The question is it okay to eat cheese before bed, or does it give you nightmares? The expert will say that in the absence of signs, common sense, if you experience nightmares after eating cheese, then don't eat cheese before bed. So you can find out many things that are good or bad for your sleep by listening to your body and estimating how sleepy you are. These are some of the colleagues that helped with this work. And I think this is where I'm going to stop, and I will stop sharing. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Darakian. Really interesting talk. And we didn't fall asleep, which is good. So we have several questions. I will read them out loud for you. Are devices which measure your sleep, like smartwatches, useful?
Well, we are currently looking into that technology in quite a bit of detail. And most of that technology, these wearables, haven't been validated against gold standard. In our hands, they are not that reliable. And it's also, you know, why do you need to look at an app to find out whether you got enough sleep or not? You know that. You just need to ask yourself, am I sleepy during the day or not? So I don't think that it helps you necessarily that much. But, you know, if people like it, there is probably not that much harm, although some people may become quite obsessed with the data coming out of these devices. And many physicians, doctors who see patients, you know, do worry about the patients coming to their surgery with the plots of their sleep and said, oh, doctor, I don't get enough sleep according to this device, and et cetera. And there is something else. You know, Simon Kiley did an interesting experiment. So he basically gave these devices to insomnia patients. But the results of the app were fake. Yeah. And so the app would say you slept very well. Yeah. Or the app would say you didn't sleep very well. And then later in the day in that experiment, people were asked how they felt. And these were people who had a complaint about insomnia and also daytime functioning. So if the app said you slept well, people reported sleep feeling much better during the rest of the day. Whereas if the app said you didn't sleep well, you know, several hours later, people said, I don't feel well. So these data do have an effect on how you feel.
Very interesting, very interesting. Yeah, indeed. We have another question. If I understood your graph correctly, we have the most level of brain activity in our deepest point of sleep. What's the reason behind this? As I would have thought it would be the other way around.
Well, the graphs I showed were responses, so bolt responses, which in essence is a measure of blood flow during a task while you are awake. And the plot where you saw that these bolt responses were highest was for the thalamus. Yeah. And the thalamus is well known to be involved in vigilance regulation. in the other brain area I showed, actually the bolt responses were lowest in the middle of the night. So there is no general pattern there. And an increase in the bolt response can mean many things. Some people look at it as recruiting larger part of that brain area to a task. So you can't read too much into it. The important thing is that you see that time course. And for that one brain area, we saw a nice circadian time course. Whereas for the other brain area, you saw that time course that was more related to how long have you been awake, and then you saw the recovery after sleep.
Cool, thank you. Another question. I spend a lot of time inside working with my computer. Will my sleep improve if I wear glasses that filter blue light? Also, how much time should I aim to spend outside each day to benefit from the natural light?
Yeah, so that's a good point. So the more daylight you see, the less effect the evening light will have. Yeah. So if you are outside for an hour during the day and it's nice and sunny, that daylight will have a strong effect on your clock, and the evening light in comparison then becomes less important. And that's why if you go to Scandinavian countries, there is often the observation that during the winter, sleep patterns are more disrupted or later. And that's in part because during the winter, everything that matters is artificial light. Yeah. So that means that your behavior now completely drives the light exposure. Now, in terms of the blue blocking lenses, there are a number of reports that clearly, and I didn't talk too much about the wavelength dependency of these responses, but it's certainly true that these blue blocking lenses can do something. But you know, a better thing to do is to make sure that you see enough daylight. So going outside is really important.
Enjoying the sunshine. Good. Another question. Excellent talk. I have a couple of practical questions. Are naps helpful? Should we shower at night to help our sleep, or in the morning since the shower might wake us up? And finally, is lying in bed awake good?
Okay, so in terms of the last point first, is lying awake in bed good? Now, in insomnia, when people wake up in the middle of the night, and I didn't talk much about insomnia also because I don't see patients, but people may wake up in the middle of the night and worry about things. And the advice that is given in cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia is actually don't stay in bed then, but get up, go to another room, do a puzzle or whatever, and go back to sleep 20 minutes later. And it's quite striking. If you lie in bed awake and you're worried, usually people have their eyes closed. Just opening your eyes already leads to a massive change in the thoughts in your mind. So opening your eyes is already a kind of a stimulus control, but you can do better by getting out of bed. If you're lying awake in bed and you're not worried and you're enjoying it, there's no reason why you shouldn't enjoy it. In terms of naps and do people naturally nap, actually the evidence for natural napping isn't that strong as people often claim it is. Napping in some countries is probably more related to kind of protecting yourself from the heat by going inside than anything else. If we look at predictors of, for example, dementia, you mentioned that we are working with the Dementia Research Institute. Very long naps are not a good sign. And very long time in bed is never a good sign. Actually, long sleep and long naps are a strong predictor for cognitive decline. So I wouldn't necessarily say that naps are good. If you take your 10-minute nap, that may be okay. It also, though, may indicate that you don't get enough night sleep. Okay. And there are data to support that. In terms of the showers, it is true that you may facilitate sleep onset by taking a warm bath in the evening. And this has a lot to do with heat loss mechanisms that can be activated by, yes. And of course, you also are free to take two showers per day, one in the evening and one in the morning. I'm not advising against that at all.
Well, good to know that we are allowed to. another question. Researchers claim that silent sleep loss epidemic is the greatest public health challenge of the 21st century. How can we shift culture and society to change this? Wow, this is
Yeah, well, see, I don't think that, you know, chronic sleep loss is as much as a problem as people claim. It's true that there are people who don't get enough sleep. There is no doubt about it. And it's true that it's not good that these people don't get enough sleep. But if you really compare sleep durations in the 1960s and 70s to sleep duration now, or sleep durations in the 1920s or whatever, there isn't that much of a difference. And this is a story that, you know, kind of what was good for the sleep community, and it may hold in some countries, but Nathaniel Marshall, who is in Australia in Sydney, did an extensive comparison of countries and many studies. And there is no good evidence that there really is that massive a problem in terms of nowadays sleeping so much shorter than we did many years ago. And there is also a kind of romantic misconception about this. In the olden days, everything was better. Well, if you were a miner or in the 19th century and you had to work your 12 or 14 hour shifts for, you know, 6 days a week, you probably didn't have as much time for sleep as we now have. So I think it's a little bit of an exaggeration, and there are bigger problems on this planet than some people not getting enough sleep. But there are people who don't get enough sleep, and that's not good.
Good, thank you. Another question. I'm sorry to hear that you received negative feedback on your research from the public. What advice will you give to a PhD or early career researcher who received a similar feedback? How should we present complex scientific ideas to the public?
Well, I mean, the example I gave was a rare example, and I think it was quite funny. I also showed that example to show that sometimes you do research and then people say, of course, I've known this already. Yeah, and that's fair enough. I mean, but you nevertheless now and then need to do the science to show that it's really true. In terms of reaching out to the public and, you know, dissemination of scientific information and how simple you should make it, or, you know, how comprehensive you should be, that's not an easy question. I do think that too often we see that things are being oversimplified or things are being exaggerated. You know, the entire, you know, the sleep epidemiology and, you know, the entire planet collapses because people don't sleep enough. That's terrible, you know, and to some extent that is irresponsive interactions with the media of scientists. So my advice is, yes, be precise, don't exaggerate, talk about your limitations. And the public is intelligent.
Okay, thank you. So we run out of time, but let's do one last question. We still have some questions, but yeah, as I said, it's 10 past five. So I will ask you a last question. Your plots on how sleepiness depends on age only went down to people aged 20 to 29. Are there studies on sleepiness in children? Are they more or less sleepy? Does asking this because I feel like I've never been as energetic as when I was a child.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. And there are data on that. And children can be extremely alert. Yeah, they can sleep extremely well during the night. And during the day, then they are very, very alert. What happens during adolescence, puberty, there may be changes in sleepiness. They may become more sleepy, but that's also because there may then come sleep restriction. Yeah. And but it's probably true that there are many children, you know, that's 7 to 10 who have almost perfect sleep pattern. They get good sleep at night, and they are very alert during the day.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Derkin. It's been a very enlightening way to finish in this amazing research week. And I would like to thank everyone again, the attendees and the speakers and the team, Stacy, Sophia, Arman, Tariq, because it wouldn't have been possible with all the effort that PhD students and early career researchers put into this week.
Okay, well, thank you for the invitation. Have a good weekend.
You too.
And good luck. Take care. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.